Kalorama, a recorded books high bridge imprint, presents The New Fire, War, Peace, and Democracy in the Age of AI, by Benjamin Lewis Buchanan and William Andrew Imbrie. Read by Stephen Bell Davies. Introduction. Fire begins with a tiny spark. The spark can come from two sticks rubbed together, a smoldering match left astray, an electrical fault, or any number of innocuous yet volatile triggers. The spark ignites and, with the right fuel, grows exponentially. What was once a nearly invisible flame can quickly turn into a small blaze and then explode into a wildfire that rips across landscapes and destroys everything in its path. Fire's power comes not just from its heat and smoke, but also from its acceleration in speed and force. Unchecked, it will rage and rage until there is nothing left to burn. And yet, for all the destruction that fire can bring, it is also the basis for civilization. From its earliest days, humanity's capacity to start, control, and stop fires was the prerequisite for warming caves and everything that followed. Many of the most consequential inventions, metal forging, steam propulsion, glass making, and electricity, arose from this ability. Some scientists theorize that even the development of the human brain itself depended on cooking meat over flames, which meant that food required less energy to digest. In so many ways, human beings learn to harness fire's exponential power, using its might for good and taming its dangers. Humanity has also wielded fire's destructive force. The Byzantine Empire used it to great military success, first during the siege of Constantinople in 672 AD, and then in the centuries that followed. In battle, Byzantine troops shot a specially formulated compound at their enemies, one that would burn even when it came into contact with water. Once the compound hit the target, the power of fire would kick in, torching enemy equipment and causing soldiers to flee. Since then, the flames of war have only become deadlier. Could there ever be another force so productive and perilous, one so essentially defined by the exponential growth of its core components? Welcome to the age of artificial intelligence. In choosing the metaphor of fire to explain this age, we reject the more common and more hopeful assertion that AI is the new electricity. Electricity is everywhere in modern life, so ubiquitous and so utterly mastered by our society that we take its safety for granted. Without a second thought, we dwell and work side by side with the massive buzzing wires that crisscross our neighborhoods and empower our lives. Largely because of the professionalization of electricity generation, transmission, and usage, nearly every modern human interaction with electrical current is a beneficial one. AI will follow the same path, so the electricity metaphor implies transforming society no less profoundly and no less positively. While that may be true one day, for now this view is far too rosy. We have not come close to mastering AI as we mastered electricity. Today we encounter AI as our distant ancestors once encountered fire. If we manage this technology well, it will become a tremendous force for global good, lighting the way to many transformative inventions. If we deploy it too quickly and without adequate foresight, AI will burn in ways we cannot control. If we harness it to destroy, it will enable more powerful weapons for the strongest governments on Earth, as they engage one another in a combustible geopolitical competition. That the frequent analogy to electricity denies this wide range of possible outcomes doesn't make us more secure, only less prepared. Three sparks ignite the new fire: data, algorithms, and computing power. Today's AI systems use computing power to execute algorithms that instruct machines how to learn from data. Due to exponential growth in the size of datasets, the capability of algorithms and the power of computers, the age of AI has brought advances that have stunned even some skeptics. AI has demonstrated superb capability in areas ranging from speech and facial recognition to video generation, language translation, storytelling, and beyond. As a result of these advances, AI has come into our homes and our businesses. It empowers Siri and Alexa, provides recommendations as we navigate the web, helps steer our cars on the highway, and silently makes so many of the technological systems we use every day work better than before. Even more impressively, AI systems can now mimic decidedly human qualities, such as imagination and intuition. In rapid succession, these systems have reached milestones, including success at games that require fiendishly complex strategic planning, and breakthroughs in some of the hardest science problems that experts had once thought were more than a decade away. It is overwhelmingly likely that even more surprising and powerful AI advances will come in the years ahead. AI's new capabilities are both marvels and distractions. Too often, the discussion of AI focuses on what the technology can do, overlooking the people who invent, refine, and deploy it. Commentators make breathless predictions about the arrival of superintelligence capable of exceeding humanity's cognitive capabilities, but far less often do they consider how AI interacts with geopolitics. And yet history reminds us that from chariots to cannons, from airplanes to atomic bombs, more important than the innovation itself is how and why people wield it. An inquiry into AI must focus on us, how we harness the new fire, and for what purpose. This book is about human choices, the decisions people in governments, companies, and universities make about AI will prove to be some of the most consequential of this young century, both technologically and geopolitically. AI compels us to ask anew some fundamental questions about humanity. How do we govern? How do we fight? And perhaps most importantly, what do we fight for? We present three competing and sometimes overlapping views: the evangelists, warriors, and Cassandras, for what to do about this new technology. The evangelists believe that humanity should tend the new fire for the benefit of all. Those who hold this view believe that AI can transform human civilization for the better, and worry that using AI as a weapon of war and geopolitics distracts from all the good it can do for civilization. They are often AI researchers and pioneers themselves, motivated by the desire to solve intelligence as a means of cracking some of the thorniest mysteries in science. At a time when scientific discovery and invention seem more difficult than ever before, evangelists want to build machines that can see, create, plan, and aid humanity in reaching its full potential. Just like the discovery of fire, discoveries in AI, or by AI, will unlock a new standard of human life and a new level of understanding. If we manage it well, the evangelists believe the new fire's exponential force can propel us all forward and offer positive sum benefits for everyone. The warriors want to harness the new fire not only for science, but also for national security. Just as nearly every military since the Byzantines has been ready and able to burn its enemies with one kind of flame or another, many strategists today think that AI can be useful in deterring and winning wars. They believe that few matters are removed from geopolitical competition, and that nations will act on AI as they do on any other global issue, such as climate change or pandemics. As self-interested players, usually competing and only sometimes cooperating with one another. Democracies in particular must be ready to wield the new fire, warriors believe, or they risk watching from the sidelines as autocracies use AI to centralize control at home and extend their influence globally. To be slow to adapt is to cede the advantage to others. The need to deploy AI for security and geopolitical advantage might be unsettling to contemplate, the warriors acknowledge, but it would be naive to ignore it. Sometimes the world is more zero-sum than we would like to admit. The Cassandra's fear, the new fire, named for the Trojan priestess whose prophecies were apt but ignored, they contend that AI is less useful and more dangerous than many proponents anticipate. While the warriors worry that democracies might be too slow to apply AI to national security, the Cassandras fear that nations might be too quick to do so. AI's intrinsic weaknesses concern them, as does its potential to be both powerful and inept. They warn that AI systems will catastrophically fail at moments of great importance. If deployed too quickly and without adequate foresight and ethical constraints, AI might be wildly destructive and negative-sum. Not in the sense of a vengeful Terminator, but rather in the emotionless might of a roaring blaze. We use the views of the evangelists, warriors, and Cassandras to reflect divergent assumptions and varying points of emphasis. But at times the lines between the categories blur. While some people may hold the same view across many issues at the intersection of AI and geopolitics, others shift perspectives depending on the question. An evangelist can worry about the risks of AI, just as a warrior or a Cassandra might believe in the technology's potential benefit for the common good. All three perspectives have their merits. AI is technically impressive, and it seems likely that the technology could assist the discoveries that will make life richer and better for much of humanity. At the same time, AI has already become a flashpoint between the United States and China, and between the forces of democracy and autocracy more broadly. Both superpowers invest billions of dollars each year in AI, not only to advance humanity, but also to gain an economic and military advantage over the other. This competition, like the new fire itself, is only accelerating. The warriors are right to want democracies to win, but the Cassandras are right to warn of a race to the bottom with deleterious effects on human rights, the reliability of the technology, and international security. The interplay between the three views will determine what AI can do, who will benefit from it, and which consequences will befall us. Representatives of each view will appear here in this book. Some push AI's technological frontier forward, making breakthroughs that were once unfathomable. Others marshal these inventions to advance the interests of their nations, whether democratic or autocratic. Still others urge caution, warning that we are crossing ethical lines or creating unintended consequences. Sometimes the Cassandras may succeed with their efforts to minimize risk, but geopolitical competition and AI research will nevertheless continue to accelerate. AI will shape statecraft, and statecraft will shape AI. AI and statecraft. First, we must explore the sparks of the new fire. Part 1, Ignition, examines the triad of data, algorithms, and computing power. These chapters show how modern AI systems mark a notable change from previous decades of software engineering. With some kinds of early AI and other traditional forms of software, developers gave instructions to their creations and watched those machines carry them out by rote. With modern AI, software developers instruct the system on how to learn, giving it data or environments from which to extract patterns and providing ample computing power. This different technical architecture creates the possibility of AI systems capable of making their own inventions and forming their own insights. As these chapters show, the geopolitical implications of the evangelists, technical advances in data, algorithms, and computing power are inevitable, and the warriors are quick to spot them. Academic contests and computer image recognition, which draw on massive datasets, prompt governments to develop tools to automate imagery intelligence analysis. Algorithms that dominate at some of the most complex board and video games on Earth spur military investments and advances. The creation of ever more powerful computer chips propels AI systems to new technological heights, yet also leads to fierce showdowns between rival nations over control of the supply chains for chip manufacturing equipment. But for as much as AI can surprise us with its successes, it can also confound us with its failures. Today's AI systems are astoundingly sharp in some areas and mind-bogglingly inept in others. Worse, the systems fail in ways that exacerbate pre-existing biases, give illusions of impartiality, provide little or no explanation for their decisions, depart dramatically from human expectations, reveal a total lack of understanding, and snowball into greater harms. All outcomes that portend significant negative geopolitical consequences. We close part one by exploring the technological roots of these failures, showing how they often emerge from the architecture of modern AI itself. Part two, Fuel, shows that despite AI's many failings, its successes are too seductive for the warriors to resist. Nations are already putting AI to use in service of their security interests. Government planners believe that AI will inevitably have strategic implications, and they covet the advantages it bestows on their nations. In this global competition, it is not just governments that matter, but also the private companies that invent cutting-edge technology. Yet the relationship between the private and public sectors is more contentious today than in the past, especially in the United States. Traditionally accustomed to leading the way in high-tech innovation, the Pentagon is now trying to catch up. It leans heavily, and with mixed success, on technology companies and academic researchers in its efforts to gain a military edge over other nations. In contrast, some strategists argue that China is more unified in its approach, if not always in its execution, drawing heavily on the products and employees of its domestic technology companies to tighten its autocratic grip. Both nations are using AI to invent the future of war and peace. Perhaps no invention in this geopolitical competition is more relevant or more controversial than lethal autonomous weapons. Warriors dream of an AI that transforms the battlefield, neutralizing incoming threats and targeting enemies as needed, while still adhering to ethical principles. They imagine new tactics and capabilities, like automatic threat identification, drone swarm warfare, and advanced missile defense. They assert that too much human oversight will slow combat down, that only AI-enabled systems can react rapidly enough against AI-powered aggressors, and that military systems and machines must become even more capable. These dreams are inching closer to reality. Many U.S. military leaders view lethal autonomous weapons as key to managing the threat from China, a nation of rapidly increasing concern to American defense planners. In coming to this view, the Pentagon draws on an array of tests showing how lethal autonomous weapons would increase the strength of the U.S. armed forces. China, meanwhile, says it would support prohibiting fully autonomous weapons on the battlefield, but that it is not opposed to their development or production, a position that seems untenable. Experts in the human rights and technical communities urge caution to both nations, warning that AI won't be up to the job of killing justly. Kinetic weapons are not the only way to do harm. Cyber capabilities are an essential tool of modern statecraft, and AI is poised to transform the digital landscape. AI systems already help plan, deploy, and thwart cyber operations, which have become only more potent and ubiquitous, Worse still, AI systems are themselves vulnerable to hacking and deception. They possess all of the regular weaknesses that plague other computer systems, plus new and vexing flaws. As geopolitical competition intensifies, warriors will compete to hack each other's autonomous systems, taking capabilities out of their creator's control and exploiting the weaknesses to gain an advantage over others. Even more insidiously, AI offers the prospect of automating propaganda and disinformation campaigns, adding more fuel to the new fire. AI can write text that seems genuine, generate videos that seem real, and do it all faster and cheaper than any human could match or detect. AI also shapes the terrain on which disinformation efforts unfold. It influences which stories appear on Facebook news feeds, which tweets show up on Twitter timelines, and which video pops up next on YouTube's autoplay. Major internet platforms have become arenas where worldviews clash every day, with malicious actors trying to coax corporate algorithms to make their messages go viral, and companies trying, and often failing, to use AI to keep disinformation and other forms of hate at bay. Part 3. Wildfire looks at how the flames can burn out of control. It focuses on how mitigating fear and achieving security is an indelible part of modern statecraft. But each nation's quest for its own security can threaten others and exacerbate fear, especially when new technology is involved. It is this fear that leads warriors to take AI out of research labs and incorporate it into weapon designs and war plans, including for nuclear conflict. Since arms control around AI is nascent at best, governments use AI to aid their intelligence efforts to gain peacetime advantages over others. Such fierce AI-enabled competition in peace and war only increases the potency of combat and the risks of inadvertent escalation. When it comes to geopolitical competition, a worrying possibility runs throughout this book, that AI will do more for autocracy than it will for democracy. In this view, autocrats will simply be better able or more willing to use AI to control people, information, and weapons. Unencumbered by privacy laws, they will have access to more data. They will use their central planning systems to drive algorithmic research and build ever faster computers, turning autocracy's biggest weakness, the need for centralization, into its greatest strength. AI will help entrench power within the state, aiding in surveillance and repression, and compelling private companies to assist as needed. For national security, the argument goes, AI will also improve the tools in the autocrats' arsenal, such as lethal autonomous weapons, cyber operations, and disinformation. In autocracies, ethical concerns will be nothing but minor speed bumps. Equally troubling is the growing consensus that democracies will struggle to adapt to the age of AI. If this consensus is accurate, privacy concerns, civil liberties, and ethics will hamper data collection and slow the adoption of technological advances, as at times should be the case, given the rights of citizens in democracies. Companies will continue to develop cutting-edge algorithms, but they will be used for increasing advertising effectiveness, improving product recommendations, or advancing medical treatments, not strengthening and securing the state. The will required for ambitious long-term public projects, including for developing advanced computing power, will never materialize in democracies consumed by political infighting. In this view, ethical concerns will make democratic governments hesitate to develop lethal autonomous weapons, even as autocracies' new capabilities, including hacking and disinformation operations, put democracies on the defensive. As a result, democracies might struggle in peacetime, lose battles in wartime, and fall behind autocracies in general. In the words of one of the most quoted AI thinkers of our moment, the historian Yuval Noah Harari, technology favors tyranny. Yet nothing is as inevitable as these forecasts suggest, and this dystopian scenario will arise only if we mismanage the new fire. When it comes to AI, democracies have advantages, dictatorships have flaws. For each subject of the chapters that follow, from technical matters like the three sparks of the new fire, through geopolitical subjects like lethal autonomous weapons, democracies have the opportunity to forge a way of using AI that assures, rather than undermines, their ideals and their security. It will not be easy. Democratic governments will have to deploy AI in concert with both their allies and their own private sectors. They will have to wield it to defend themselves, guard against its use as a tool of disinformation, and yet respect the human rights and fundamental values at the core of the social contract. Even the competition with autocracies need not be all-consuming, and there may be ways to manage the spirals of insecurity that seem inevitable to so many. The evangelists, warriors, and Cassandras agree on one thing. For better or worse, the geopolitical decisions that democracies make today will govern the future of AI as surely as the technical decisions will. Much remains in the balance, and the stakes could not be higher. Enormous data sets, massively capable algorithms, and rapidly growing computing power have lit the flames. Democracies and autocracies are together already fueling the blaze, developing AI and deploying it in peace and in war. They will try to harness the heat and smoke to their benefit, sometimes with success and sometimes courting immense risks. Their choices and the competition that ensues will determine where the new fire will bring warmth and light, and where it will burn everything to ash. Part 1. Ignition. Chapter 1. Data. HAL 9000 appears on screen for only a few minutes of 2001, A Space Odyssey. But the spaceship computer is considered one of the greatest film villains of all time. So adept with language that it can understand human speech and even read lips, HAL wields great power by controlling the ship's mechanics, and eventually becomes an antagonist for the crew. In the actual year 2001, such a performance from AI was still science fiction, but two researchers at Microsoft were doing their small part to turn fiction into fact. The computer scientists Michelle Banco and Eric Brill studied a key part of AI known as natural language processing, or the science of developing computer programs that can recognize, interpret, and manipulate written or spoken words. Plenty of such programs existed at the time, but none of them were very good. Banco and Brill wondered what might be holding these programs back. They found that most software engineers working on natural language processing fed their programs about 1 million words of text, which the programs used to learn the patterns of human language. Compared with the trillions of words spoken by humanity every single day, 1 million struck Banco and Brill as a trivial number. They became curious about what would happen if natural language processing programs had access to a lot more data. To test their idea, they devised an experiment, choosing a fairly simple and standard natural language processing task. When asked to fill in a blank in a sentence with one or two similar but distinct words, like principal ending AL and principal ending LE, could the AI determine which was correct? Banco and Brill tried this with four AI programs and found that, interestingly, the programs all performed similarly at the task. Despite the fierce competition between software engineers striving to design the best computer code, the differences between the programs didn't actually matter all that much for performance. What determined results, they realized, was the amount of data supplied to teach each program how humans write and speak. With the standard 1 million words of sample data, each program chose the right word about 82% of the time. When Banco and Brill increased the amount of sample data to 10 million words, the exact same four programs did better, with three of them exceeding 90%. With 100 million words, accuracy pushed 95%. And with 1 billion words, three of the algorithms selected the right word around 97% of the time. The experiment underscored a key and counterintuitive idea. In the age of AI, software performance sometimes wasn't about the code, it was about the data. Banco and Brill were prescient. Their 2001 experiment anticipated a paradigm shift that would transpire fully only years later, one that would place data at the center, not just of AI, but of society. In 2008, Wired magazine published a paean to what data could do, proclaiming that it would replace every other tool that might be brought to bear. Out with every theory of human behavior, from linguistics to sociology. Forget taxonomy, ontology, and psychology. Who knows why people do what they do? The point is they do it, and we can track and measure it with unprecedented fidelity. With enough data, the numbers speak for themselves. In such a worldview, data carried both technological and geopolitical significance. Google's Peter Norvig, a prominent computer scientist, said in 2011, "We don't have better algorithms than anyone else. We just have more data." Ginni Rometty, IBM's then CEO, spoke of data as the next natural resource. Similar ideas soon proliferated as data storage costs dropped and the size of databases all over the world increased exponentially. "Data is the new oil," became the mantra. "China is the Saudi Arabia of data," was the corollary. Access to vast stores of information could fuel both AI and autocracy. Amid all this hype, one question persists even years later. Is data actually the new oil? That is, a resource that will become an underlying driver of economic activity and a cause of geopolitical conflict? The centrality of data to modern life and global affairs is more often proclaimed than it is examined. Few people know, for example, that this omnipresent oil analogy originated not from careful technical study or detailed geopolitical analysis, but from grocery store marketing. Coined in 2006 by a customer loyalty expert and data scientist named Clive Humby, the phrase was introduced to capture what Humby saw as the future of customer relations. As future chapters will show, data is only part of the picture for AI and statecraft. The oil tagline is simple and neat. It is also misleading. Like oil, data is important, but that's where the similarities end. Data is not a broadly useful commodity, but rather information that is often specific to a particular context. It is not a finite resource, but a foundation. Data does indeed matter, yet not in the ways so many expect. As Banco and Brill foreshadowed, and as this chapter explores, data is at the center of a paradigm shift in AI that ushered in a new age of progress. This paradigm shift made the evangelists hopeful about what might come next, caused warriors to dream of how data-driven AI could serve their national interests, and prompted the Cassandras to worry about the implications that would follow. The rise of data was the first spark that lit the new fire. It is the beginning of our story, not its end. Why data matters. Gottfried Leibniz preferred logic to bloodshed. An eminent German mathematician, he discovered calculus in the 17th century and made a number of other fundamental breakthroughs. Unlike most mathematicians, however, he concerned himself with philosophy as well. Leibniz understood the consequences of philosophical, political, and theological strife. He wanted to find a better way. Turning to the methods of rationality that governed his work in mathematics, Leibniz aspired to create a formal system of logic that would be capable of processing all of the information in the world and deriving insight, a system that would provide a trustworthy mechanism for interpreting data and resolving debates without fighting. It would go far beyond even math, as complex as calculus, and would be capable of answering a wide range of questions. Leibniz wrote that if such a system existed, there would be no more need of disputation between two philosophers than between two accountants, for it would suffice for them to take their pencils in their hands and say to each other, "Let us calculate." Leibniz's ambition, in some broad sense, was an early aspiration toward creating AI. His idea contained an important characteristic that would later become the foundation of modern computing, a structured and replicable method of processing information to draw conclusions. The mathematician who discovered calculus might have hoped that the entire world would be subject to the same kind of rigorous analysis, if only the right rules and structures could be found. Leibniz's vision has yet to materialize. He was a pioneer in building mechanical computers capable of performing basic operations, such as addition and subtraction. But these computers were obviously nowhere near complex enough to resolve political and philosophical disputes. There is simply too much data in the world, and that data is too complex and too varied for one single logical system to understand it all. No one set of known rules or analytic structures can process everything. Politics is still more akin to philosophy than it is to accounting. Still, digital computers are the successors to Leibniz's early constructions. Computer languages provide a way for humans to give instructions to machines in a form they can understand. These languages encode some of the messy information from the world into a logical system that can form the basis of replicable calculation and analysis. Every computer program is a series of complex but carefully defined commands for how the program should interact with the data that it receives and use that data to inform its conclusions. Centuries after Leibniz's proposals, AI came into vogue early in the modern computer age. Organizers of a summer research project at Dartmouth University coined the phrase artificial intelligence in 1956 and spurred the beginnings of the field. AI researchers hoped that the structures of computer programs would eventually become powerful enough to form their own kind of intelligence. Early AI pioneers devised a type of program called an expert system and fed these systems carefully crafted rules for making decisions, often expressed in the form of logical statements like, if X is true, then do Y. The rules depended on the task at hand and on human knowledge of how to accomplish it. If the system was supposed to help oil engineers ensure performance from a well, programmers crafted these rules with input from drilling experts. If the goal was to determine the optimal price for a particular service, experienced field sales representatives helped shape the machine's behavior. To some degree, this rule-based method of processing data worked for many purposes. By the 1980s, two-thirds of Fortune 500 companies employed expert systems as part of their daily work. In reality, these early attempts at AI were only as good as their rules. Because of their rigidity and dependence on human-crafted instructions, expert systems were no substitute for intelligence. For very narrow tasks, they worked well enough. But when required to confront ambiguity or demonstrate flexibility in more complex tasks, they failed. Even in the days when expert systems were viewed with the most optimism, any hope of matching humans' general capabilities seemed to many observers to be a very long way away. A competitor to expert systems, first developed in the late 1950s, lurked in the background: machine learning. Machine learning pioneers aspired to give rise to AI in a new way, one that differed both from the potential of expert systems and from Leibniz's vision. Machine learning systems focus on data, not on rules. It was on machine learning systems that Banco and Brill performed their experiment. The systems do not depend on humans painstakingly encoding knowledge and insights in the form of if-then statements and other explicit instructions. Rather, they distill what they need to know from vast stores of information. It is this difference, learning as opposed to simple execution, that makes machine learning both powerful and threatening, capable of delightful invention and also devastating failure. At the core of the most powerful modern machine learning systems is something called a neural network. The workings of these networks are not intuitive to most people. They sound a bit abstract and arcane, more like a plaything dreamed up by a bored mathematician than the kind of tool that actually would be useful to anyone. But the remarkable fact is that a lot of the time neural networks work. They can turn data into insight. Represented with code, a neural network consists of lots of nodes, which are called neurons. The word neuron usually conjures associations with the brain and complex neuroscience, but in AI it has a far simpler meaning. A neuron is just a container that stores a value, such as the color of a pixel or the result of a mathematical equation. These neurons are typically grouped together in layers, which are themselves arranged in sequence. Neurons make up layers, and layers make up the network. The number and size of the layers depends on how complex the task of the network is, with more neurons yielding more capability. Neural network-based systems are referred to as deep learning systems because of how these layers are stacked alongside one another. To illustrate how neural networks function and why they matter for national security, consider imagery intelligence analysis. It is a task that every major military performs. It begins when a satellite, drone, or spy plane takes a picture of something of interest. Analysts then try to determine what is happening in the picture. Depending on the resolution of the camera, the image might be blurry and hard to make out, and analysts could debate various possibilities for what it might show. During the Cuban Missile Crisis, for example, American intelligence officers analyzed photos of the island landscape to confirm the presence of Soviet missiles. The right neural network can help identify objects within images and resolve some of these and other analytical debates. A neural network might look at a blurry picture of a vehicle and determine if it is a military tank or a civilian jeep. To do this, the network's first layer of neurons initially receives the image, with each neuron in the layer corresponding to the color in a numerical form of each pixel in the picture. From this initial input, the network will eventually reach its conclusion. For that to happen, however, the data in the first layer of the neural network has to cascade to the next one. In the simplest network designs, every neuron in the first layer connects to every neuron in the second layer, and the strength of these connections varies between each pair of neurons. The numbers contained within the second layer of neurons are determined by the numbers in the first layer, which represent the color of the pixels in the image, multiplied by the strength of each connection. A higher value in the first neuron and a strong connection, represented by a larger number, will yield a higher value in the connected neuron. Every neuron in the second layer is connected to every neuron in the third, which is in turn connected to every neuron in the fourth. The data flows in this way through the network, with the numbers inside neurons in one layer and the strength of their connections to the next layer determining the value of the next layer's neurons. Eventually, the data, transformed by all of this math, reaches the last layer, which is called the output layer. The output layer of a neural network has one neuron that typically corresponds to each possible answer. In the example of a neural network that determines if a vehicle is a tank or a jeep, the layer will have one neuron that represents a tank and one that represents a jeep. If, after all the cascading of data is done, the number within the tank neuron is larger than the number within the jeep neuron, the network has concluded that the image is likely a tank. Essentially, the answer the output layer gives is the result of a very long mathematical equation. It begins with the image to be analyzed and then proceeds through each layer of the network, factoring into the equation the strength of each connection between neurons. The result at the end, the judgment about whether the image is a tank or a jeep, depends both on the image itself and on these connections. If the connections are tuned properly, the network will conclude that pictures of tanks are tanks and pictures of jeeps are jeeps. There are far too many connections and other parameters in a neural network to set by hand, so humans do not determine the strength of these critical neuron-to-neuron links, and thus the flow of information through the network. Instead, many neural networks use a machine learning approach called supervised learning to set the strength of these connections. Rather than the explicit step-by-step reasoning of expert systems, classical computer programs, or Leibniz's formal logic, a supervised learning system depends on what AI researchers call training data. The training data consists of examples that include the right answer. For instance, the training data for a simple system that distinguishes images of tanks from images of jeeps might include 1,000 pictures of tanks labeled as tanks, and 1,000 pictures of jeeps labeled as jeeps. Banco and Brill showed that the more training data, the better the neural network performs. All of this training data is typically provided to the neural network before it is deployed for use. Supervised learning systems learn all that they will ever know from the patterns in the training data, since they do not receive other instructions from their creators. No matter how obvious a fact is to humans, if it is not present as a pattern in the training data, a supervised learning system will never know it. Similarly, as Chapter 4 will show, if the training data is not representative of real life and indirectly includes patterns that are not emblematic of how the system is supposed to function, the system will have no way of identifying and counteracting those inadvertent biases. The centrality of data is perhaps the most important idea in all of supervised learning. This dependence on data arises because a neural network using supervised learning is doing just that, learning. For each sample in the training dataset, the network checks how it would have performed on that sample and compares it to the answer provided by humans. If in one training example the network incorrectly classifies a picture of a tank as a picture of a jeep, it then slightly adjusts the strength of connections within its network so that in the future it will be more likely to classify the picture and others like it as pictures of tanks. By changing the strength of the connections between neurons, the network changes the flow of data and thus changes the numbers that arrive at the output layer that forms the system's answer. The network makes these subtle tweaks to the strength of the connections between its neurons again and again and again, as it processes all of the training data it is given. By looking at all of these images and comparing them to their human classifications as specified in the training data, the network learns which patterns make a tank, and which make a jeep. It learns to perform very well on the training data and on real-world examples that look like the training data. When the network is fully trained, it will have learned all that it can from the data. It is ready to get to work on fresh data, for which there is no right answer provided, such as a picture that has not yet been classified as containing a tank or a jeep. If this new data is similar to the data on which the network was trained, For example, if the new tank shares some of the same features as the tanks that the network has already seen, such as a long gun mounted on a turret, then a well-trained network will usually be able to recognize it correctly. While the power of neural networks learning from data is now widely accepted in many fields, for decades there was great doubt. Years after Banco and Brill's work, it took new approaches in two old and vexing computer science problems, image recognition and image generation, to show the world what neural networks could do. 15 million images. Feifei Li was born in Beijing, China, in 1976. When she was 12, her father immigrated to New Jersey to start a life for the family in America. 4 years later, Li and her mother followed. A day after her arrival in the country, the family car needed repair. Li's father, who spoke only basic English, brought her with him to the gas station and asked her to tell the mechanic to fix it. Though she spoke little English herself, she communicated with gestures until the car was fixed. From then on, she realized she had to become the mouth and ears of her parents. Li was an academic star, especially in math. She so impressed one teacher at her local high school that he devised advanced classes for her during lunch hours. The same teacher loaned her family $20,000 to start a dry cleaning business and helped her prepare for college. 2 years after she arrived in the United States, Li earned a scholarship to Princeton University, where she studied math and physics. On weekends, while other students partied, she often commuted home to help out in the family business. A year after graduation, she moved to the famed California Institute of Technology to pursue a PhD that blended computer science with neuroscience, and eventually returned to Princeton in 2007 as a professor. In this early part of her career, Li worked on teaching computers to recognize images, a problem that had long bedeviled AI researchers. Image recognition, at least in some form, is a task that humans can carry out seemingly without thinking. Just a few weeks after birth, an infant will recognize her mother's face. But for decades, machines lacked the capacity to recognize what was in the collections of pixels that made up images. At best, they could adjudicate between a few options, perhaps differentiating a tank from a Jeep. Whereas an effective general image recognition system had to be able to differentiate a bike from a cloud, from a woman, from a tree, from so much else. It seemed like there was just too many possibilities to teach a machine to recognize them all. Li's idea was to create a gigantic collection of pictures. The database she named ImageNet contained photographs of a vast range of objects. Buildings, Dalmatians, pickup trucks, toothbrushes, and more. Over time, it would grow to include more than 15 million images, each of which needed a human operator to painstakingly caption and place it into one of thousands of categories so that it could eventually serve as training data for supervised learning systems. Li paid Princeton students to do this labeling work, but the process still took too long, thanks to the sheer volume of images. A student suggested that Li try Mechanical Turk, an Amazon service that crowdsources low-cost labor to perform mundane jobs. Li gave it a shot, and after she built a verification mechanism that double-checked the workers' captions, she found that the labeling progressed much faster. In 2009, Li and her colleagues published a paper about ImageNet. It generated very little scholarly attention, and Li thought that an annual competition would boost awareness of the massive database. She realized that the vast collection of captions in ImageNet could be used to compare AI image recognition systems. If the caption offered by the AI matched the caption given by the humans who had first labeled the pictures, then the AI had succeeded in recognizing the image. Li named the contest the ImageNet Large-Scale Visual Recognition Challenge, a mouthful of a name for what some would later call the Olympics of Computer Vision. Everyone who entered the competition would gain access to the same giant compilation of images. The winner would be the system that best extracted the patterns and insights from this data and used it to classify a subset of pictures selected by the competition organizers. Designing such an image recognition system was exactly the challenge that Alex Krzyzewski and Ilya Sutskever had been seeking. The pair were PhD students at the University of Toronto, where they studied under Jeffrey Hinton, the neural network pioneer who will be discussed in Chapter 5. In 2012, Krzyzewski and Sutskever decided to enter the ImageNet competition, and together they devised a system that came to be known as AlexNet. AlexNet, like so many neural networks, became remarkably adept at its assigned task. Raw data went in one side, was processed by a bunch of neurons, and then a verdict, in this case an image caption, came out the other side. To accomplish this, AlexNet relied on 650,000 neurons arranged in 8 layers, with more than 60 million total connections between neurons. The strength of each of these links shaped how the data moved through the neural network and ultimately helped determine the answers that AlexNet gave when it was presented with an image. AlexNet used a supervised learning system to determine the optimal connection strengths between neurons, and it did so to learn the patterns in the ImageNet training data. Like most machine learning systems, AlexNet operated without direct human guidance. Krzyzewski and Sutskever did not tell it obvious facts about the images it would see, like the notion that 4-wheeled vehicles were probably cars and 2-wheeled vehicles were probably bikes. All they provided was ImageNet's millions of images and the labels on those images. By assembling the world's largest collection of human-captioned pictures, Lee and her team had provided not just a means of evaluating image recognition systems, but also the infrastructure for improving them. Networks that trained on Lee's giant collection of labeled data would learn many more patterns than those trained on data sets that were smaller or contained less precise captions. The information contained within ImageNet was a rising tide that would lift all image recognition boats. While neural networks and supervised learning had been applied to image recognition before, Krzyzewski and Sutskever made several improvements in the technology's efficiency and scale, enabling AlexNet to learn more patterns and extract more information from the captioned pictures in the ImageNet database. Among other improvements, AlexNet was bigger than a lot of other image recognition programs, with many more neurons and connections between these neurons. During its training process, AlexNet tweaked each of these connections time and again to best capture the patterns within the vast ImageNet collection and prepare the network to recognize images when the 2012 Olympics of computer vision began. It worked. AlexNet beat out the competition, including many of the expert systems that were still prominent at the time. In the most common ImageNet scoring system, top 5 accuracy, in which the competitors got 5 guesses for each image, AlexNet succeeded around 85% of the time. The next best system managed only 74%. It was a triumph for Krzyzewski and Sutskever, for Lee, and for AI progress more generally. AlexNet's success helped establish machine learning as the soon-to-be dominant paradigm in AI research. Olga Rusakovsky, a Princeton professor and an organizer of the ImageNet project alongside Lee, said that 2012 was really the year when there was a massive breakthrough in accuracy, but it was also a proof of concept for deep learning models. It really was the first time these models had been shown to work in context of large-scale image recognition problems. What happened next revealed a lot about AI and its place in the world. First, more researchers started using neural networks, and the wheels of technological progress spun quickly, leading to rapid and widespread improvements in image recognition. Within 2 years, nearly every ImageNet competitor used a neural network architecture similar to AlexNet's. In each subsequent competition, these systems all got a lot better, in part because millions more images were added to the ImageNet database, and in part because the programmers continued to improve how their neural networks learned. In the 2014 competition, the winning entry, known as GoogleNet, scored better than 93%. GoogleNet was not only more powerful and more efficient than all of the other competitors, but it was also on par with humans who engaged in the same image recognition task that year. Second, while the rapid progress in supervised learning was a technological marvel for everyone, irrespective of citizenship, it did not occur in a vacuum. The ImageNet competition very quickly took on geopolitical overtones, especially as an imperfect proxy for measuring nations' relative capabilities in AI research. The winning entry in the 2015 competition used further innovation to recognize almost 97% of images. Perhaps more interesting, though, was that the system's lead creator, Kai Ming He, had been educated in China and worked for Microsoft Research Asia in Beijing. It was the first time a China-based organization had won. The next year, ImageNet's geopolitical stakes became more apparent. A research team from the Chinese Ministry of Public Security won one of the main components of the competition, a sign that government agencies had realized what machine learning could do for them. By 2017, the last year of the competition, more than half of the entering teams were based in China. That year, two researchers from a Beijing-based autonomous vehicle startup called Momenta devised the winning system. ImageNet was the most famous competition in AI, and it had gone global. These developments marked a rapid shift in both technological and geopolitical terms. Neural networks with supervised learning systems and massive data sets had tackled a problem, image recognition, once thought to be manageable only by living creatures. In the span of just 5 years, these systems had gone from, at best, pretty obscure academic research projects to the spark for a new era of data-driven AI research. The successive ImageNet competitions and other supervised learning breakthroughs showed that, with the right training data, machines could classify text, images, sounds, and more. The potential applications were vast. After ImageNet's success, giant training data sets came into expanded use, teaching neural networks tasks ranging from detecting fraud in credit card transactions to forecasting the price of fine wine, which they could do more accurately than even the best wine connoisseurs. Lee's work and the work of other pioneers kick-started a rapid technological transition towards supervised learning. It was a sea change that seemed primed to reach wherever there was data, including, as Chapter 5 will show, the Pentagon and other military and intelligence organizations. But as the ImageNet competition was taking off, another machine learning innovation would soon show that data could also serve a different and more creative purpose. From images to imagination. Ian Goodfellow had wanted to be the one to teach computers how to recognize images. For almost 5 years prior to the development of AlexNet, he had thought on and off about the problem, trying a variety of approaches. None of them worked as well as what AlexNet and its successors managed to achieve. And so, as a PhD student in machine learning at the University of Montreal, he turned his attention elsewhere. In 2014, Goodfellow and some friends were out at a bar in Montreal, celebrating the graduation of a fellow doctoral student. His friends had been trying to devise a system that did the opposite, in some respects, of what the ImageNet competition aimed to achieve. They wanted a computer to generate images rather than recognize them. Their plan was to design a program that could perform intricate statistical analysis on sample photographs and then figure out what was in them. Here was a chair, there was a table, and over there was a lamp. The code could then try to use that information to come up with new images of similar objects. Goodfellow was skeptical. Image generation was a tricky problem. While supervised learning systems were by that time fairly proficient at using training data to learn how to recognize images, generating something new that fit the style of the data was more akin to imagination. And imagination seemed like a fundamentally human ability. Goodfellow was imaginative himself. In high school, he had devised his own language with a phonetic alphabet and enjoyed his creative writing and literature classes more than those in science and mathematics. He hadn't really wanted to attend college, but ended up going because his parents said they would pay for it, and not for other pursuits. He picked Stanford because it would allow him to delay choosing a major until junior year, and to leave and return with more flexibility than other schools. Ever the literature student, he liked that John Steinbeck had attended Stanford intermittently as well. After his first year, Goodfellow decided to mimic the literary icon and take a break from college. He moved to Scotland with two friends, animated by the goal of becoming a writer. To pay the bills, he tried to land a day job anywhere he could, sending in applications for entry positions in factory work, fast food, and even forestry. No one hired him. And when his savings dwindled, he went back to Stanford. He took classes in neuroscience, chemistry, biology, and computer programming, thinking he would major in biomedical computation. Eventually, he decided to focus on AI, but still encountered his share of setbacks. Among them, Google rejected him for an internship. It is impossible to know if this circuitous and often non-technical path helped Goodfellow grasp what it would take to develop a system capable of mimicking imagination. But in debating image generation over beers with his friends that night in Montreal in 2014, he hit upon an idea. The only thing better than one neural network would be two neural networks. Instead of his friend's plan to give explicit instructions to the system about which objects were present in an image and how they could be mimicked, Goodfellow wanted to kickstart the process with data. He would task one neural network with figuring out how to mimic some desirable data, such as photographs of people, and another with evaluating the work of the first network. He explained some early intuitions about how this could work to the assembled group at the bar. They didn't buy it. When the celebration broke up, Goodfellow went home. In his own words, he could be stubborn and argumentative, and the idea of two neural networks forming a single machine learning system lingered in his head. While his girlfriend slept, he started to work then and there. His prototype showed strong promise on the first try. He later estimated that it had taken him only an hour to create it. By around midnight, he knew he was on his way to something big, and he began emailing colleagues to find collaborators to work on developing the idea further. What Goodfellow eventually devised came to be known as a generative adversarial network, or GAN. GANs quickly became one of the most significant innovations in machine learning, and Goodfellow earned the moniker, in what can only pass for techie humor, of the GAN father. A GAN is an unsupervised learning system, meaning that it doesn't use vast amounts of painstakingly labeled training data that supervised learning systems like AlexNet employ. Instead, the GAN uses data as a form of creative direction. It aims to create new information that resembles the data it is given, generating possibilities that mimic but do not duplicate a group of samples. It is this capacity for mimicking imagination and creation that makes GANs so special, even among other unsupervised learning systems. At the core of a GAN's power is Goodfellow's deceptively simple idea of using unlabeled data to drive competition between two neural networks. The two networks' relationship is somewhat akin to that between a forger and an appraiser. The first neural network, known as the generator, is tasked with devising something that looks like the data to be mimicked. It may be a picture of a human face, or a video of a scene, or a musical composition.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.